Hello, everybody. Welcome to another edition of the Fanboys Anonymous FanTracks podcast. I am your host, Tony Mango, and joining me on the panel here is, from Everything Action, Chris Cheng. What's going on, Chris?
Not much, Tony. How are you doing?
Not too bad, but a little bit tired, but my energy level is going to go up a little bit because we're going to be watching Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 1, and that's a fun fucking movie. So you can't be tired when you're watching that, right?
Oh, can't. No. It's full of excitement.
And the reason we're doing this, obviously, is because of the upcoming release of Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 coming out in about 2 weeks or so. I think it's like May 5th or something.
Exactly. Cinco de Mayo.
Really? Oh, yeah, that's right. So it's a party movie, and it's a party atmosphere for that day, so people are going to get real drunk.
Oh, yeah.
This movie might be even better when you're drunk. I don't know for sure, but it's great on its own. And what we're going to be doing here, if you don't know what the FanTracks podcast is it's an audio commentary track. We're going to be watching the movie, and we basically are approaching it from the point of view of just, like, bullshitting with your buddies and hanging around, cracking jokes and stuff like that. We didn't work on the movie, so we can't talk about, like, well, it was hard to get the lighting in this thing and all that other kind of crap. We could, but it would be bullshit, so I don't think you guys want to hear us do that. But we also can't provide you the movie on YouTube if you're watching this there, or if you're on the iTunes and stuff, you can't watch the movie at the same time on iTunes anyway. But what you can do is you can sync up your DVD or your Blu-ray or your stream or whatever you're watching this on, and I'll be giving you a countdown of 3, 2, 1, play, and just make sure that you bypass all the FBI warnings and the menu and all that kind of stuff, and it'll be a black screen, and it'll start off with a little title card that says that it's Earth and the year and all that, because no intro stuff is going to be in this from what we're watching and everything. So if you keep that in mind, then get ready, because we are going to start in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, play. So there we go with the Earth thing should be popping up just about like now. 1988, year after I was born. Good year, I'm assuming, since I was alive.
This actually could be it. This could be like the hospital visit. It's a boy.
Oh no, he's ruined. Good music in this, of course. A lot of people love the soundtrack, and I don't know what they're going to be doing for the soundtrack for the new movie, because I purposely don't want to know ahead of time.
Oh, I don't want to spoil it then. It's good.
They have a good... I know they have a Hasselhoff track at some point. That's the only thing I had seen.
Well, it's like late 80s, early 90s track, just to like match up what's going on. So, because the one thing about the movie was like how surprisingly good the soundtrack was. So, just because the first teaser trailer to this was just bizarre, it like got people confused. And then when this movie came out, it was such a smash hit. It was like, holy shit, you should totally see this. Like,
and this movie, I mean, we should definitely talk at the beginning of this when it's all, you know, no action and everything. Everybody looked at this, myself included, as, well, this will be the first failure. Like, there's no way they can take a movie about a tree and a raccoon and make it good. And it's fucking great.
Oh, yeah. It's on itself. Like, if this wasn't part of the bigger MCU universe, it's a good sci-fi movie.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure how familiar are you with Guardians of the Galaxy. Like, the different versions they kind of had throughout the years.
Not too much. I know, like, some basic stuff, and a lot of it I learned after the movie came out, but, like, I know that this isn't the original team, because Yondu was a part of the original team.
Yep.
But, like, I did not have a clue what Cosmo the space dog was when this movie came out. And
really? Oh, yeah, it's, like, deep. That's deep. Like, not a lot of people aren't familiar with the cosmic Marvel. Like, that of the Marvel things I know, it's, like, the spiritual, like Doctor Strange stuff, and then like the cosmic, which is like the Guardians, and then Silver Surfer when he's not with Galactus. Like, it's just
right
other things. So
I know more cosmic than I know the mystical. Like, I even when Doctor Strange came out, it was like I knew Eye of Agamotto and I knew who Wong was, but when people are starting to bring up like the, what are they called, like the Night Dreamers or something, and I'm like, I don't know who those people are.
Yeah, that's too far for me.
Like, you ask me about Thanos, I know a little bit. You know, I know we're probably gonna get like Corvius in the next movie, and I know about like the Heralds of Galactus and stuff, but like Guardians always went under the radar for me. I never knew what Guardians of the Galaxy was.
I caught the Yondu like version 2 team, which is just like they had all these misfits. Like this is before Star-Lord was just like, I should be in charge. Like this is just Yondu and a bunch of people in Speedos. Like no idea.
And this, I think, is the first movie that they had this where you didn't start off with the Marvel intro, and that threw me off so much.
Yeah, there was like that page flip formula, which they just avoided this time. Only because, yeah, this thing, which, like, this is how you knew to, like, stop talking to theaters and get ready.
And this is plus a good intro that they've got going on, too.
Oh, really, really long. Before it was just the pages and the Marvel. Now it's, like, zooming out and around. But, man, Peter not looking at his dying mother is such a dick move. I remember, like, looking at people in the theaters going, like, right, like, the fuck? He didn't look at his mom? Like, asshole.
Meanwhile, years later.
Meanwhile, in Prometheus...
And this is another intro thing, too, that was just sort of like, I would not have expected a lot of the things that happened at the beginning of this scene, too.
Oh, yeah.
It's very serious, and it's got that ominous kind of like, in the background, and it cuts into something that I was like, I was still nervous when we're watching the scene of him with his mom, and I still wasn't sold on anything yet. As soon as he starts dancing, I'm like, all right, I'm going to like this movie, you know?
Yeah, I think that purpose they did that to not. But, like, the last trailers, like, once this movie was making money, and they kind of spoil half of it, like, they showed everything. They're like, you haven't seen this movie yet? Here's some clips to kind of get you there.
I usually try not watching that kind of stuff.
And some movies stop doing that. Like, a lot, like, some movies stop making, like, a lot of trailers. Like, to, once it's in theaters, to brag about how good it is.
Yeah.
But only like blockbuster movies that obviously are like already have your money, they'll make like other trailers to kind of like get more people into it or see it again.
Yeah, like a couple weeks after it comes out, it's like you missed all these good shots from the movie. Like,
yeah, it's like, hey, remember this? Come see it again. Give us $8 to watch it again. Like, yeah, Force Awakens has like
dog.
That was his real dog.
Yeah, that's his real dog in that scene. It's the same one that is Cosmo, I think.
Huh.
Also, we didn't know, like, anything about the story of this movie when it was coming out. We had no idea that there was going to be a whole Infinity Stone, but...
I mean, I figured, like...
Yeah, it seemed like it would fit, you know?
Yeah.
We did see a little bit of the idea of the orb, and a lot of people were like, the orb must be one of them, but...
Yep.
This is also before we knew that, like, the Infinity Stones could be encased into something, and...
Well, they were like a Tesseract thing. That was the... thing about Dark World, Thor's Dark World.
Yeah, the ether in that one.
Yep.
Love this song though.
It's like Redbone, the band. I think it's like their only hit. I gotta like check, but it's like I had to Google them to figure out who sang this.
And every time, I don't know about you, every time that I'm listening to this song, I want to just strut around and kick a bunch of little rat creatures.
You want to hang out like an abandoned warehouse, the equivalent of this?
It really sells you on the movie, though. You're like, how many minutes into the movie, you know, like 5-6 minutes or so?
You understand, like, the seriousness around it, but the funny about Chris Pratt, like, how he doesn't take things serious like this.
And James Gunn had done, I think it was Scooby-Doo.
He did Scooby-Doo?
It was like his biggest movie or something. So it's like, I was not familiar with James Gunn at all.
Really? I love his movies.
Let me double check to see what movies he's done. Maybe I have seen some of them.
James Gunn has done, like, he does, for a guy, for a movie guy, or like a writer and stuff, he does crazy amount of work. Like, he does, like, music videos, he does... like porn commentary sometimes because he's friends with a lot of porn stars. I'm not joking. And then like he also wrote a video game. Like it's funny. And like, are you familiar with like trauma movies and stuff like that?
No.
He was Lloyd Kaufman is another like kind of like movie director. He's in this movie too. He's a cameo, and it's like that was his first like writing job was for him. And then it's like years later he like, because Lloyd Kaufman's like a director, writer, actor, and it's like James Gunn like got into the Hollywood thing, and like Lloyd isn't, but it's like he still honors that guy, like his like mentor. So
there's a lot of cameos in this movie too, like his brother being one of the Ravagers, yep, and the stop motion for Groot. And looking at his IMDb right now, so he was the screenplay and the story for Scooby-Doo and wrote Scooby-Doo 2. Slither, I never saw. Human Z, of course, I've never seen. Like, a lot of weird Slither things.
Worth seeing Slither. And, all right, one, this part right here, this part of the trailer kind of overplayed a lot.
The who thing?
Yeah.
Yeah. It is a good send up, though, because it's like, in movies and stuff, it's always like, you know, I'm Bond, James Bond. Oh my God, he's Bond. And it's like, right, every once in a while, you're going to come across somebody who's like, who the fuck are you? Like, no.
Plus, like, they're very aware that not a lot of people knew Guardians of the Galaxy. You know, like, they knew their target market wasn't, like, a lot of hardcore Marvel people. So it played on that.
Plus, it's played like, on the who names themselves Star-Lord, you know? Like,
well, it was, like, the late 70s, so that's why. But and this is something like Stan Lee doesn't take credit for, where like he's like, yep, I invented that. Uh-huh. This one's like not a Stan Lee thing.
No, this is like Jack Kirby and like, oh God, I'm blanking on the guy's name that was like the main creator of this now. But it's got some Kirby elements to it and everything. Like just,
yeah, because Kirby was one. And Kirby was the one like tripping balls on LSD and just making up really weird characters.
And apparently the name of the ship is the Milano, named after Alyssa Milano. Which I don't blame him. Alyssa Milano, if you're that age, she's like the perfect one that you would crush on. If you're at any age, she's the perfect one to crush on.
So my thing is that Star-Lord knew he came from Earth, right? And he knew, like, he has a spaceship. How come he doesn't just, like, go to Earth?
Yeah, I always thought about that too. It's like he probably by this point, with him and the Ravagers, have had some kind of interaction with Earth, because there's also the idea of what's up with the batteries on his tape player.
Yeah, how does he power it?
It can't possibly last forever. And is there really going to be an issue where like he goes to another planet and it's like, do you have any Earth batteries? And they go, oh yeah, I go there all the time. Well, then wouldn't he want to go back? You know, like there's a lot of like plot holes when it comes to that kind of stuff. There's Barit. He's apparently somebody in the comics.
Yeah, she's I guess again, if you read a lot of cosmic Marvel series stuff, she's a like an important character in that, but minor role in this one. Super, and it's super like if you don't know her, you just don't know her.
Yeah, I had no idea who she was. I just assumed that she was like, that they were pulling a Captain Kirk kind of thing, and they were like, oh, you know, it'd be kind of funny if he was, like, banging an alien chick. And I'm looking up after the movie, and it's like, you know, top 10 Easter eggs, and it's like, Barit was the first comic issue, is whatever. I'm like, out of all the TV shows I've seen, all the comics that I've read, all the movies, never came across a Barit before, but that's because there's so many goddamn characters and everything, like.
Yep. Well, can't blame him. Michael Rooker. It's like this is just Michael Rooker. Like it's not
exactly
even Yondu.
Yeah. I still don't know what the Yondu character is because he is just Michael Rooker. So it's like if Yondu's like this in the comics, then perfect casting. If he's not,
he's
I don't care.
Not like in the comic version, he doesn't have like really fucked up like you know shark teeth, and then he
he's got that
he's actually like
mohawk.
A noble like kind of like swords guy, not like this where he's just like. Like a redneck.
Yeah, he's very southern in this.
Yep.
Like I'm he's just get you, boy. Like
he's just like his character from like The Walking Dead, kind of.
Apparently, he's going to be a big part of Volume 2. It's going to be like the Ravagers are going to be half of the villains.
Yeah, well, I guess like they get because the thing about the Ravagers, which was one of the newer things, is that they're just mercenaries. They just follow Yondu. but at any moment they can rebel. It's like just because they're just like they're all like separate contractors then.
Yeah, they're all like just pirates. There's no like loyalty.
Yeah, so I guess that comes in play into the new movie where someone besides like Yondu like tries to fight for control, and they're just like, oh, that guy's in charge now.
Which may or may not be Sylvester Stallone's character.
I mean, that makes sense because it's kind of like, well, here comes this like dieseled space guy.
Oh, I want to be a Ravager.
All right, Space Rambo, you're in charge now.
Yondu can change. I can change. Now, Ronan the Accuser, I was familiar with before the movie because I had seen him in references with like Thor and stuff.
But I've seen him in other things, but as a good guy, because he's like he's not really a bad guy.
He's not like pure evil like he's presented in this movie. He's kind of just like. Kind of like Galactus a little bit, where it's like, yeah, he's bad, and he's bad more often than not, but there's going to be those times where it's sort of like, let's fight for the better good, like...
Mm-hmm. Like, you wouldn't hammer some dude strapped in a chair, you know, like, you wouldn't smash some guy's face in to make, like, a blood pool, but, like, you know, like, he still was, if you crossed his path, and, like, if you held him back in a goal, yeah, he'll fight you, but not like this.
Yeah, now he's just sort of like a zealot kind of weird cult leader kind of.
Mm-hmm. He reminded me of I know you don't know a lot of Mortal Kombat references, but like Shao Kahn is like this.
Yeah, kind of just like that vicious overlord type of guy.
Plus Shao Kahn has like a hammer, so it's just like, man, they stole this.
I'm really curious if they're going to do a lot with Nebula in Infinity War. She's a big part of that in the comics.
I wasn't familiar with Nebula a lot. I was just like, oh, okay. So, because I like Thanos in the 90s where he didn't really bring up his family a lot. It was just like, you just fought him. Like, in the original Infinity War, like, comic arc, where he just wanted to impress death. That was his whole concept.
Which... Are you on the same page as I am about this, where we know the Cate Blanchett is Hela, and if she's like, you know, basically sort of like an overruler of death in certain different ways, why not just kind of combine the two? Because Cate Blanchett could play like, well, death and Hela the same thing, and it's just sort of like, I can see Cate Blanchett being one of those like manipulative people that can control Thanos, you know?
Mm-hmm. But the thing is, Death didn't have like a goal, but this Cate Blanchett's character like wants to destroy Asgard, so
that's true. There's Stanley different. Of course, we gotta bring that up.
Yep.
The fucking movie with the tree and the raccoon, and they end up being as beloved or more than some of the other characters that are out there. More people like Groot than like Ant-Man.
Yeah, that's weird to think. People just like simple-minded creatures then. It's like, that's insane for Marvel to figure out, because like, there's certain characters that always are universal, going to be around, always going to speak to people, like Spider-Man, Captain America, Batman, whatever. Then you have like, here's a tree that only says its name. Like, okay.
Yeah, imagine the pitch to the people that, like, it's good that Marvel Studios has enough people that are all comic book geeks that they know a lot of this stuff. But imagine a guy like a Bob Iger, who really isn't that steeped into the lore, and he's like, so, what are some of the other ones that are coming up on the slate that you're working on? And it's like, well, we've got a sequel to Captain America. It's going to be, like, a political thriller. We're going to get Robert Redford. It's going to be real timely. Oh, that sounds great. You know, talk about, like, peace and war and everything. What else you got? We got the sequel to Thor. We've got, you know, they're going to have this big action set piece where, like, the whole world might explode because other realms are merging. All right, sounds kind of interesting. I don't quite get it, but what else you got? Well, we got one with a tree. what do you mean with a tree? No, that's great. The tree's great. All he says is, I'm Groot, but don't worry. Well, his talking raccoon friend will help translate. It's like...
I think it's like James Gunn is more of like a not like horror action or anything like that. It's kind of like he would not be in a Disney movie associated based on his track record. And just like, yep, and we're getting the guy who made, like, you know, this fucking, like, graphic Rob Zombie music video. Just like, what? That guy?
Yeah, well, you can't talk to him yet because he's working on a porn thing, but...
Yeah, that's exactly it. They're just like, oh, okay. That's why James Gunn didn't do a lot of, like, on-screen, like, Disney interviews, because it's like, you do not want to put him in front of kids or anything.
But it's a good thing that they got a good cast here. They got a good... Whoever, like, broke the idea of them setting it in this universe, the way that they set it in with, like, incorporating Thanos into the picture and doing all that, it made a good, like, framework for this to work with. Because without that connectivity, it does seem a little bit weirder, you know?
This doesn't... At parts, it does feel like a filler movie just because you get more, like Infinity Stones involved. But... on its own, like, it does have its own, like, arc. Like, it's just... Because, again, Thanos is just kind of watching from his house, like, what's going on here? He's no involvement. It's all about, like, you know, the stone kind of switching between the Inquisitor and then, like, them. So... And then, of course, like, Thanos is like, well, I gotta get my stone back so I can make my glove.
It sounds so weird. 20-something movies by the time we get to Infinity War, and it'll be like, so the overall picture of this whole thing was there's this purple dude who's got this bling that he wants on his glove.
Yeah, like, that's the goal for, like, just to get Infinity Wars, is that this glove needs stones.
I'm so glad, too, speaking of with Rocket's voice just reminding me of this, that they didn't do the Australian kind of Cockney thing.
Yeah, which, again, I was used to that from, like, the video games where Rocket was featured, and it's very, like, dirty European sounding, and it's, like, it's just Bradley Cooper, who I imagine, I could not, you know, Bradley Cooper could do this kind of voice.
Big-ass fucking gun. Poor Groot. Now, I don't know too much about the Nova Corps. Were you familiar with them ahead of time?
I was.
But I know, like, a little bit, because like, I know that they're kind of like sort of a bit like a poor man's Green Lantern Corps, kind of, but...
Oh, no, they're blatantly the Green Lantern. Except you don't need to be, like, chosen. You could just find... You can be recruited by them personally, or if you find their helmet and put it on, you just become a Nova person.
That's how the kid Sam gets it, right?
Yep, his dad was a Nova Corps person, so he just puts on his dad's helmet and just like, I'm a Nova person now.
And John C. Reilly, that's like, I wouldn't have pictured him popping up in a Marvel movie outside of something crazy, and you gotta put him in the craziest movie, of course. Glenn Close was like, what the fuck, she's gonna be in this kind of a thing? Like,
yeah. Well, I'm not surprised. Once you kind of play Quill de Vil, just like anything you're in now, it's just whatever.
But you imagine acts a lot well of these people are probably like, when they talk to their grandkids and stuff, it's like, I'm going to be in a superhero movie. Oh, who are you going to play? Like, you know, you're going to be Aunt May or whatever? No, I'm going to be Nova Prime. Who?
That's not someone I know. Well, no, not yet.
Here's the usual suspects. I wish when they were doing this that they would have had Benicio del Toro on the scene for it, so he could have just popped up and started doing Fenster lines.
Oh, man.
Calls his whole rocket, there was and he pops over and he's like, who stole a fucking truck?
I mean, I wish there's like a behind the scenes extra where he gets behind this just to like do that, like on his break.
This is one of my favorite movies, Usual Suspects. And apparently in that interrogation scene, it wasn't planned for them to be cracking up all the time. But they kept laughing because Del Toro wouldn't stop farting. Which is like, that's so good. Peter, so
I did like that in the trailer too, had that scene with the lineup and the finger thing. And I actually thought they would censor it. But like the trailer scene and this version are different.
And the same thing with Rocket pulling his crotch. They cut that out of the trailer stuff, and
yeah,
it's in the movie. the dude that was just in the scene a minute ago, Peter Serafinowicz, next to John C. Reilly, after seeing the movie, I thought that that was Lee Pace without makeup on.
It's like, all right, you're doing two roles, Lee.
Yeah, I was like, well, they must have just had him on that because he's wearing the makeup and the other thing or whatever. And then when I was looking up the cast afterward, I'm like, Serafinowicz? And then I'm like, oh, fuck, yeah, of course it's him because I've seen him in other things. And like,
yeah, he's in a ton of things.
Brain fart when I was watching the movie the first time.
I remember him from Shaun of the Dead.
I've never seen that, actually.
You've never seen Shaun of the Dead? Oh, my God.
Nope. Right, I saw Hot Fuzz, but wasn't the biggest fan of it.
All right. Well, it's like, if you don't like one of them, you're not going to like a lot of them. Because I like assumed so, yeah. Funny tone. Think about this. Every time Vin Diesel is saying, I am Groot in this movie, he's getting paid at least, like, 20 grand.
Well, he did do it in multiple languages, so... He put a little bit of effort into that with, like, Yo Soy Groot or Me Amo Groot or whatever. It's fact, vocabulistics. Wonder if he looked at a Mike Tyson transcript to figure that quote out. His vocabulistics. Now, I don't remember. Was it this guy or is it a different guy that Nathan Fillion is?
No, Nathan Fillion's the big monster later.
Okay. And he's going to be in Volume 2 as a potentially two different people.
Yeah. I like how they're very, like, teased, like, about it. Like, they still haven't told what Sly's character is, or what Nathan Fillion is going to be, or... I think there's another, like, another famous actor that I'm not mentioning. But for a long time, they didn't tease what Kurt Russell was going to be.
Yeah, and then eventually when they were like, he's a planet, we're like, huh?
Yeah, like, okay. And then it's like,
I'm also his dad. No, he's his dad. He's also his planet.
It's like, is that? It's like, it's because then it begs the question: it's like, does his Star Lord's mom have cancer because she fucked a planet?
That's a creepy looking shot of Groot, not Groot, Rocket. Of course, we get the Peter Quill shower scene, but we don't get the Gamora one. Which is disappointing.
I like how it wasn't water. It was just like Cheeto water. Like it's whatever they bathed Trump in.
It's like they squeezed out a bunch of carrots.
Yeah. Oh, anyway, the old man next to the guy with the dreads is Lloyd Kaufman, by the way. And he's in a blink and you miss it cameo.
I wouldn't be able to tell him who he is either. You gotta assume a lot of these people are like friends of his and stuff like that, because it's like, You don't have any lines. Just stand there.
Yell shit.
Yeah.
I like how this prison, the clothes has no rhyme and reason sometimes. Some people have shirts. Some people have like tank tops.
Short sleeves, some people
One's wearing a full jumpsuit. Anyway, I think this is Nathan Fillion being hosted right now.
That makes sense. Because you really can't tell with the face, so... Kind of like Simon Pegg in Force Awakens.
Oh, yeah.
Put it behind something you can't really tell, and then they're still in the movie, but... Nobody would be like, oh, that's Nathan Fillion in purplish tint.
Yeah, I did not know Simon Pegg was in Force Awakens. He kept talking about it, and I was like, I did not see him.
Apparently Tom Hardy is going to be a stormtrooper in the next one, kind of like what Daniel Craig was.
Which is fine. I mean, we can say we're in that movie. We're also stormtroopers somewhere in the movie.
I like that dude that just popped up a second ago where he later on with the whole, that was my favorite knife. It's a good scene. And then we get our first shot of Drax. Which, of course, I'm most familiar with Bautista for his WWE stuff from over the years. And I was just like, oh, God, they cast Bautista in this movie. He's going to be a terrible actor. Pulls it off.
Yeah, surprisingly. I think, like, if you ever seen his earlier movies, you'd be concerned, like, when you start kind of acting on the side of wrestling, kind of like what The Rock was doing at the time.
He did something called, like, Man with Dragon Fist or something.
Oh, he was in the Man with the Iron Fist.
Man with the Iron Fist, which probably was just as good as Iron Fist was.
Oh, man.
Because that was actually not really all that great.
I actually like watching the Man with the Iron Fist way better than I would see Iron Fist. You're Bautista.
I was so waiting at any point in this movie for him to do his moves from, like, his standard finishers and stuff. Like, for him to just pull out a Bautista bomb out of nowhere, and that entrance should have had pyro, you know?
Yeah, him doing the, like, double gun thing.
Right.
I think, like, most wrestlers stopped doing that thing, because once The Rock started doing rock bottoms in movies, it's like, it got really gimmicky to do that. I think John Cena stopped. Even John Cena had that in, like, The Marine. I think he has famous moves, like his choker moves and stuff like that.
Now, I was not familiar with Drax outside of... I knew Drax as being really tough guy in the cosmic universe that wants to kill Thanos. That's, like, all I knew about him. But there's a little angle that they put in with him being, like, I don't understand metaphors and stuff like that. Ended up being one of the better jokes of the whole thing. Like, why would I do that with my finger on his neck and stuff? Like,
mm-hmm. That's good of use of just getting people familiar with the universe and, like, how, like, our normal interactions don't always make sense to, like, space people. Even this coming scene right here where he's explaining his wounds, it the people he's talking about, like, we have no idea what it is, but it because the way Chris Pratt delivers it, you understand it.
Mm-hmm. All we know is, like, when he says a Kree girl, we know what the Kree is, but... I mean, even a lot of people that were watching the movie don't know what the hell the Kree is, because they don't know anything about these movies. So they're kind of like... They're going in blind, you know? They're like, well, Batman's going to be in this one, right? Like, that kind of crap.
Mm-hmm. I think Gamora technically is a Kree? I'm not sure. I think she... I forget. It's like... She's also blue in the original one. So they made her green. Everyone got, like, a color palette swap. Because Drax is supposed to be green.
Yeah, Drax is definitely green. Actually, James Gunn addressed that the other day. He was saying, like, why do people think that he's green? He's clearly gray. But he does have a little bit of a greenish hue to him. So I can see that, too.
Yeah, it's a lighting thing.
It's gotta suck to go through all that makeup, though. Like, hours and hours of them putting prosthetics on you and spray painting you and...
Yeah, like... It's like, you want the look, but you also don't want to look too bulky and a fake, like latex look, because I'm pretty sure, like, they added a bit more detail to Bautista, but then being, like, Gamora, they just kind of, like, all right, we're just painting you green. Like, today, here's what you're getting.
Basically, yeah. It's no, like, well, we need to add something, like... I mean, there's a little bit around her eyes, but...
Yeah.
Clearly, it's not, like, that crazy. So, it's, like, does it really take hours and hours just to make her green, you know? Like, give the poor woman a fucking break. Figure out some spray paint system and make her not have to wake up as early in the morning for shoots.
I mean, back when they did, like, X-Men for, like, Mystique's character, that's a full-body, like, latex thing. And it's, like, that's a pain in the ass. Yeah. Oh, yeah, this is taken directly out of Star Wars.
I mean, it is so Emperor Palpatine.
This is a throwback to other Thanos things, especially from Avengers 1, because that's who he's talking to, is the voice.
Yeah, the other.
Yep.
Who is, what's his face from the Buffy series? He's married to, the redhead. Oh my god, I'm blanking on her name too. Allison. Something with an H. Hannigan.
Really?
And he really served no purpose other than to get killed to show that Ronan is
not messing around.
Not to be fucked with, yeah.
You know, all this, like, crap on his face. Yeah, look, it's Cable.
I think he's a little bit weird in this scene, though.
Yeah, yeah. What's your thoughts of Josh Brolin being both Thanos and Cable in two different movies now?
I really hope that they do some kind of reference about that in the movie. Deadpool has to say at some point, just be like, hey, Thanos, I mean, Cable.
Yeah.
This smile coming up, too, is so, like, a weird choice for them to just be like, why don't you have this, like, shit-eating grin on your face?
Yeah, it's like, it's too weird. Maybe because it's like watching Thanos smile is just bizarre. It's like the huge chin.
And it's like, what's he, like, is he one of those type of people that's like, he's happy no matter what kind of a thing? Like, his number two dude just got killed. And he basically said, like, you better not fuck up, dude. And you still got this job to do and whatever. And then he's like, yeah, but it's a good day. I had pancakes. This was amazing. Like, you know, just like, my chair's comfy as hell.
I mean, if he's not staring, Thanos' palace made no sense because it seems like space debris. And then he's staring at nothing when he's like turning around.
Well, maybe it's like when old people sit out on like their front porch and watch cars go by. He's just sort of sitting there in the like the asteroid field, and every once in a while a spaceship goes by, so you're like, oh, look at that one. That's a nice one.
That's what he's up to, just staring into traffic.
Drinking some lemonade. The chair actually rocks back and forth. He's like, ah, it's a nice day.
So I really like this scene. This was really cool to watch the background going on. It's not focused, but you know it's there. I like that storytelling.
Yeah, where you can tell in the background everybody's waiting for this to just be turning to shit. And, you know, Groot's going to be one of those type of characters. You can't really do too much with Groot other than to keep him as, like, a lovable type of dude.
Oh, yeah.
Which, by the way, it would have been great if we would have advertised this podcast as, like one of the normal episodes and just said, I am Groot over and over again. We should do an I am Groot edition of the
FanTracks. I am Groot commentary.
Instead of being like, Groot's a pretty funny character, just go, I'm Groot. I'm Groot.
Like a bunch of people to keep that going for 2 hours.
Or just record like
on I am
Groot, one I am Groot it. And set it on repeat.
See, I like Groot's powers because they're not really defined. They're just like, if it makes sense to the situation, it's a power now. Like,
You can make a shield out of branches, sure.
Sure, yeah. But that's the thing. Like, Groot I wasn't too familiar with, but it's one of those things where his powers don't have a predefined set. He can make shields, he can grow, he can, like, make leaves, you know, just whatever.
And he's eating the leaves in that one scene. You know, the whole thing with Rocket being, like, their tech guy, when they cross over with the Avengers in Infinity War, they have to have some kind of scene where he and Stark are together.
I hope so.
And he's just kind of like, I'm working on a new suit with a fucking raccoon, like.
Or he builds his own kind of Iron Man suit using, like, spare parts.
Iron Rocket, raccoon.
Totally would love to see that.
Basically, out of any of the people that are in this group, I mean, other than really Gamora, actually, now that I'm thinking about it, she's the only one that wouldn't have a great interaction with Tony Stark, because she's kind of just like the angry one. Drax doing the whole not going to understand anything. Tony Stark will throw out a line and it'll be like, I don't get it. Peter Quill's, they're going to have some quips back and forth. Groot's going to be like, you know,
just the most lovable person there. Well, if you think about this in Avengers sense, Groot is kind of like the Hulk of the team.
Yeah, kind of. You got Stark as a raccoon. You got Hulk as a tree.
you got Captain America is kind of like Gamora.
Yeah, like a non-angry version of Gamora.
Yeah.
Kind of keeping up the fight sequences and the ideals and stuff.
And Star-Lord's like every other character. Like
maybe Thor is Drax.
Yeah. Because, like, Thor doesn't always get, like, Earth, like, culture and slang. Same thing with Drax. He doesn't kind of get metaphors and, like, Quill's weird, like amateur attitude.
And he's kind of like the secondary tough guy of the team, sort of.
Yep.
The whole leg bit is great.
It is like a running joke with Rocket that I love that. Like, he brings it up again later. Spoiler.
I'm kind of... if you're watching this movie for the first time with our audio commentary, what the hell's wrong with you?
This shouldn't be your first time watching Guardians.
No, not at all. I hope in the second movie, in Volume 2, there's a callback to that where they actually do need whatever the part is. And Quill is like, oh, come on, that's bullshit. And then it's like, oh, we really could have used that, like, that arm or something, you know? Like,
yeah. Well, James Gunn, if you're familiar with his writing, like, he will reuse things just because it's, like, a theme. So I'm hoping he's smart enough to reuse it. Because that's another thing I love, like, the comedy about this. Like, how it's, like, the rule of three, the comedy mm-hmm. style. It plays. So, another thing about freaking Nova Corps people is that they don't really need, like, these kind of weapons. Like, they are a weapon.
Yeah, they have, like, an energy projection type of source to them if they're, like, real Nova Corps type of crew, right?
Right. But maybe in the movieverse, they're breaking up where the Nova Corps, there's, like, divisions, maybe, where, like, the ones we're used to in the comic are, like, the elite, and this is just, like, the foot soldier army of it.
That makes sense. Like, Nova Corps is just sort of like Galactic Police, and if you were like the SWAT team, you're the ones that have the power, kind of a thing.
Yeah, I hope they address that, because I really want to see it like Nova. But it's weird to think that there's a character named Nova, and then there is a division of Novas that are Nova Corps, and that's just like, come on, that's, they did not think out the names through.
Oh, it's kind of like the Green Lantern thing. I mean, you're the Green Lantern of Earth, and so is five other people.
Yeah, which so made it less special at that point.
At that point, it's like, you know, the Justice League's, they get the intercom, and it's like, well, Green Lantern, please report, and Guy Gardner, and Hal Jordan, and Kyle Rayner, and Simon Baz, and John Stewart, and it's like, they all just show up, and it's like, ah, I meant Hal.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. It's like, you gotta, of course, at the time, they didn't think things like that, how popular, like, the like kind of corp characters would be.
Now we've got, I'm assuming we're going to get Nova in like some other kind of movie.
I hope
maybe
so.
Like Captain Marvel. Maybe it'll be like something like that, you know? So they can't do the kid.
Right.
And Captain Marvel.
Well, the kid angles could work because Spider-Man was a kid. So it's mm-hmm. like, well, I can do the Sam version where, you know, he's trying to get used to his Nova powers, but
if they do a standalone movie, I think it'll be the kid. Kind of like, you know, like his dad, you gotta be the introduction to the world for the audience. Oh my god, I didn't know that my dad was a Nova Corps member, like that kind of thing.
Well, they don't necessarily have to be on Earth. Like, Nova Corps make more sense at this end of the galaxy where it's common to have space police.
Mm-hmm.
So they aren't tied by like having to be in Earth. By this movie proves that you don't need to make a Marvel movie that always takes place in like New York.
Right. Which is, apparently there's going to be only like a little bit of Earth in Thor.
Which is good.
Thor Ragnarok.
I want that because I want to see like beyond Asgard and the galaxy. This is like, because Ragnarok is like further. It's like one of the even further from this. It's super
Although at the
space.
Same time, I think you'd probably agree with this too. Like it'll be really fun to see the Guardians on Earth, interacting with that kind of stuff. So, but you didn't need to see it in this movie at the very least.
Oh yeah, yeah.
I'm surprised kids aren't afraid of Star-Lord.
The eyes are intense. If I was five, I don't know if I could watch that, like, see that look.
There's nothing forgiving about it. He looks like a villain.
Yeah, he looks like, because it's just, like, the most sinister-looking eyes, they're unflinching.
Just dead eyes. Like, they look like they're, like, from an insect or something.
Like, if you told me this was a villain, I'd be like, yep. This is what, like, a villain would wear.
Maybe change the hair a little bit, but yeah.
It looks like a robot with a toupee. Like, yeah. That's kind of what that look is.
It's when RoboCop's like, I'm tired of the bald look, you know?
See, not all songs in the Guardians Galaxy soundtracks are winners.
You don't like Pina Coladas?
I've heard the song way too much, but it's played ironically half the time.
Right. It is weird, though, to see him, like, floating through space with the song playing.
Yeah, yeah.
Even if I don't like a lot of the songs, like, I'm not a fan of the Pina Colada song.
Okay, okay. And, so you get what I mean about it. It's not like, I don't want to listen to this while I'm driving.
No, there's Come and Get Your Love at the beginning of it. That's a great song.
Mm-hmm.
Even though I think it's overplayed, Ain't No Mountain High Enough, I think, like, everybody, at least to a certain extent, likes that song.
Almost every wedding I've been to that always plays.
Right. And it gets everybody pumped up, and it's, like, it's actually kind of sad in this movie instead of being something, like, too energetic.
Right, right.
But, yeah, some of the other songs, it's, like, I totally get why they put it in there, and it makes sense, and I wouldn't have wanted them to change it, but, right. Yeah, I'm not going to download
Pina Colada and be like, yeah, it's fucking Guardians of the Galaxy soundtrack.
Right. They do such a good job with just, like, I mean, at this point in the movie, or if you're watching this for the first time, you're pretty much accepting of the idea that there's this talking raccoon that interacts with them. Like, you're not even thinking about it, of just kind of being like, well, why is there a raccoon still? Like, how is a raccoon in space? Did they take it from Earth? It's just, you're just kind of like, oh, no, he's a little prick, and apparently he knows how to make guns and stuff. Like, you know?
He's just a being now, like. I think at this point in the movie, they did a really good job by just mentioning what he is, but not really going to the point where, like, you have to stop and ask everyone around you, like, dude, you get why?
Right. Drax is a pretty simple thing, but it's like he's a humanoid-looking alien, and you just go, like, he's the same as Gamora. Okay, they're green and gray and whatever, but they look like humans, and it's fine. The tree thing's sort of like, you write them off a little bit. The raccoon's talking the same as everybody else's, and it's just strange, but nobody questions it. I don't remember seeing a single review after this movie came out where people are like, I wish that the raccoon would have been a human character or something.
Right, you know, right. Like, I got a problem with that joke that he makes, the Jackson Pollock thing.
that was so good.
It's good, but I'm like, how does the raccoon, like, how does Rocket know what Jackson Pollock is? And then, like, Quill's, like, in his 30s, but it's like, when did he go to Earth to, like, look, like, know art history to know what Jackson Pollock is?
Yeah, it kind of implies that he's a little kid that knows Jackson Pollock,
which is impressive. Like, if he left Earth at, like, 8 and understood it, but, like, I didn't know what Jackson Pollock was when I was, like,
hell no,
kind of like a kid. Like,
and the movie Pollock came out when we were kids.
Yeah.
So if anything, like, we should have known that, but. It's such a Southern hick character.
Mm-hmm.
You might as well have had a scene where the Ravagers are, like, putting a spaceship without, like, its tire equivalent on somebody's lawn.
Just, like, it's on cinder blocks.
Yeah. The propulsion's gone, but it'll just sit there for a little bit. We'll fix it up. It'll be a nice fixer-upper.
This would be a beaut one day. Then they just go mudding.
Flying by a bunch of spaceships, and one of them has the General Lee painting kind of Confederate flag kind of logo on it. And he is going to get the Mohawk in the next movie. Not just this little,
like, not I don't even know what you call thing. Yeah.
Kind of just looks like somebody took like a book and shoved it into his brain. And that's one of the, in the background in the tube is one of the dark elves. If I remember correctly, if that's the exact one, I think it is.
Yeah, that's from Thor. So it's like, that's kind of cool. It's kind of weird that like he keeps some of these boxes and they just like don't do anything.
Yeah, it's like, does he feed them? Like, do they shit?
Yeah, just hang out in boxes.
And Stan Lee was supposed to be in that. That was his cameo originally, was that he was going to be in one of those tubes.
As and like, they were like Stan Lee?
Yeah, like, and they thought that it was like, oh, this is a little bit creepy, because it kind of seems like you abducted Stan Lee and put him in there. But we get, a lot of people went nuts thinking, oh, that shot too, of the Celestial. When they said Celestial in the theater, I was sitting there going like, oh my god, they're talking about Celestials. Like, did not expect that to happen in this movie.
Mm.
And then they show them later, and I'm like, there's fucking Celestials in a movie now. Like, we're talking about a universe where it was crazy to think that they would do the lizard in the second Spider-Man movie. People are like, oh, he's just a scientist. He's not going to turn into a lizard in the future. And then you get Guardians of the Galaxy, and they're like, let's talk about the Celestials and, like, whatever, and you're like,
yeah.
The Deviants are going to pop up and everything. And
They go in deep stuff that, like, it's a nice way of showing it without being too overbearing, where the movie has to stop and explain.
Mm-hmm.
So this movie
you don't
knows
need to know what the Celestials are.
Right. You just know, like, they're a thing and they're huge. And, again, here's a group. I can do this now, like, for the right moment.
I like his theme, too.
What do you mean?
Groot's, like, the music in the background, the little score. It's a little bit more prominent when he's doing the whole self-sacrifice thing.
Oh,
and,
okay.
When he does the, like, the, kind of like the Firefly-looking thing at the end.
Yep. I love space gambling in the future. It's just, it makes no sense. Things die. There's fire. I love it.
It makes about as much sense as that game in Star Wars. The, that's like that chess kind of thing, but it's like the one of them body slams the other one. And somehow somebody lost money.
Yeah. I love how it's like, this is one of the first few movies where like they get drunk. Like, a lot of the other Marvel movies, it's like Tony Stark getting hammered at parties, but this is like a bar at a gambling den. Like, we just saw a space cockfight happen.
Yeah, basically.
And then
Captain America,
but
if we was in that scene, he would have been like, we should let these animals free, and like, you know, that kind of thing. And
this is very un-American.
They're like, yeah, well, we're not in America. Everywhere's America. You know?
Does this place have oil? It's America now.
Yeah. Captain America carries around a shield and a flag for all situations. Then it becomes a whole gag where he comes back to America and he's like, they're like, where did you conquer? Nowhere. Yeah, but where did you go? Nowhere. Yeah, but who's on first?
Yep.
This is a good song too. And it got to imply that the kid watched Footloose as a kid.
Yeah, this kid, for, like, he was a super 80s kid for being, like, an 8-year-old. Or maybe a 10-year-old? I don't know. Like, that kid was...
About that. I wonder if they have that information out there. Let me try to find that. Peter Quill, MCU. It was 1988, so if we go by, like, a certain age range or something... At least the MCU Wikia page says he's 37 and he was born February 4th, 1980. So he should have been 8 years old.
That was
maybe
a big
9.
8 year old.
All right, it could have been 9. He had to be 8.
8 or 9, but still, like, for an 8 and 9 year old, he knew a lot about the era.
Yeah, when I was 8, I was still, like, just watching Power Rangers and just, like.
Yeah. Like, when I hit my 20s, I relearned what my childhood was really like. Another thing is, did Gamora not know what music was? Is there no music in where she grew up?
Yeah, that's weird too. I didn't think about that. She knows what dancing is. So it's like naturally just moving back and forth, like, I don't know, that's strange. She never visited the planet that has Earth batteries, I guess.
Yeah. I also love the line, pelvic sorcery. And I also love how, you know, the space cockfight turned to them fighting.
As it does.
Yeah.
And this has nothing to do with, like, and some people looked into this movie and they really wanted, like, more of Thanos. I think we had, like, just the right amount, basically. Maybe yep. One more scene would have been okay, but like you were saying earlier, this isn't a scene that builds to the future of the MCU. This is just pure character moments, just for this movie, just for this offshoot series, and it's a good scene, too, because you get all the, you know, Rocket talking about all this stuff and everything.
Oh, this was like an Oscar scene right here, watching Bradley Cooper as a, you know, almost like PSD like raccoon talk about like being called a freak. Like it's pretty awesome.
Wouldn't that be great if it would have been like he gets nominated for American Sniper, doesn't win, and then he wins for a fucking raccoon?
He gets like a nod and then he wins it. Like what?
It's like I did the Oscar bait movie. I was, you know, it was political, and it was, like, American
I went to
pride.
An actual desert, like, I suffered in there to train, and, you know, got into the character, just, like, but I sat in a voice booth and talked about, like, guns and building things, and I won my Oscar. Thank you.
I'd like to thank the Academy for preferring raccoons over troops. That's a creepy chick, though. Cute, but...
I love
people went
Easter
nuts
egg.
In the background thinking yeah. that the one shot was Beta Ray Bill. We got a Chachari.
Wait, Beta Ray Bill's here?
No, people always thought that he was. Oh. The thing in the background, right when they're showing Benicio del Toro there.
Oh, the guy in the red, yeah.
Yeah, they thought that the red cape, and it looks like he's kind of got a little bit of like a hammer or something, so they thought that was Stormbreaker. And it was like, well, you can't tell that he doesn't look like a goddamn horse. Like, Del Toro is one of those guys. You tell me he's in a movie, I'm going to go, what the fuck is he playing, but I'm down.
Yeah, yeah.
Because this is a weird character.
I think this is actually, like, I wasn't really familiar with the Collector 2, so it's like when I saw him in this, I understood everything I needed to about him.
Right, yeah. You're like, oh, okay, he's this, like, he's kind of like the character from Tron Legacy, where you're like, he's creepy dude that is serving some kind of a purpose in this world, as weird as it might be.
Yep. He's a guy that just matches the crazy tone of it.
And it's so awesome that a couple years after this, we get, well, his brother's going to be in the new Thor movie, and it's going to be Jeff Goldblum. That whole drop-in scene, by the way, that wasn't planned.
Really?
He dropped it, and they were like, that was kind of funny. We'll just keep it in there.
That's just pure Chris Pratt, you know, being clumsy. So... I love how he still keeps the character. And his character isn't, like, too different from what he is in real life anyway.
If they wouldn't have had Chris Pratt and they would have had somebody else, I don't think the movie would have worked.
No, right. It would be, like, too forced.
Because Glenn Howerton was going to be the role for a little bit.
Really?
Which, that's kind of crazy to think of. I love It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia.
So do I. And I could see it too, but... You have to
pack
some muscle.
I can
see
it at the same time. I kind of go, maybe he would be better for somebody like a Riddler or something, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I was geeking out all over this scene, talking about the Infinity Stones and the fucking Celestials. And because this is like our first real, like...
What they could do scenes, yeah.
Like, we knew, I mean, we didn't even know that the Tesseract was an Infinity Stone when Avengers was going on.
Right, yeah. I feel like that was kind of like a rewrite. They're just like, let's just make an Infinity Stone now.
It makes sense, but you and I, like, we follow the comics and stuff, so it's like, we just assumed it was the Cosmic Cube.
Yeah, it was like its own separate thing.
Cosmic Cube apparently is an Infinity Stone, and it was like, well, that doesn't make any sense and whatever, but then...
Well, then, same thing for Doctor Strange, though. It's just like, all right, yeah. That's an Infinity Stone. Like, what?
And in retrospect, it does make more sense, because it's like, well, there's way too many things to keep track of for Marvel Comics.
Yeah, they condensed it.
Cosmic Cube, but then it's like a non-Cosmic Cube, but then the Cosmic Cube is the Beyonder, but then it's also not the Beyonder, and then you got the Heart of the Universe, and you've got the Casket of Ancient Winners, and you're just sort of like, well, how many fucking things are there, you know?
Yeah. I mean, it's good, because you can't spend, that'd be so many more movies explain everything else.
And it's so much easier to go. The Eye of Agamotto, it controls time, and that means that it's a time stone. Done.
Yeah. They understood, like, if this is, like, the same category, they'll condense it, which was a really good idea for them to do, so.
Right.
Some people won't get lost in the shuffle of, like, all the other bullshit Marvel things. I also love how this one woman who just grabbed the stone exploded this building. Like, it wasn't like she burnt up. It was like she took out, like, stuff.
Yet all of our heroes and the Collector and Cosmo and, like, all Howard the Duck, they're all fine, you know? She isn't, though. Specific shot, though, that they did a second ago about the dog, because it was like, you showed the dog earlier, you gotta make sure that everybody knows the dog's okay, because everybody would have been like, what about the dog?
Right, you gotta show that you saved the dog. So
that's
just,
why
like,
I still haven't
dog.
Seen I still haven't seen John Wick, because I know that the dog dies, and I'm like,
I really
don't want to watch the scene where the dog dies. Like,
it's so brief. I know it's painful, but it's I do not watch John Wick. You have to watch John Wick.
I know, I've heard nothing but great things about it, and I really want to watch it, but I might have to, like, skip that scene or something, you know?
That's, like, the whole purpose of the movies, to avenge the dead dog.
To this day, there's only been 3 movies that have made me cry, and the one that made me actually cry more than just, like, one tear falling down was I Am Legend, and it's because of that dog.
Yeah.
Oh, you gotta be fucking kidding me. I don't give a shit about it. You kill a baby on screen, it's like, that sucks. Like, you know,
but a dog, oh no.
You kill a dog, it's going to be like, oh, did you have to kill a dog? You know, even Jurassic Park 2, it's like, I didn't need the shot that you ate
the
dog.
The dog being eaten?
Although, by the end of the movie, when they do the whole thing with Groot, it's like, oh, don't kill the tree.
Not the plant.
And lo and behold, baby Groot is going to, oh man, that... They're going to sell so much Baby Groot shit.
You're going to see so many cosplay Baby Groots walking around the con season.
Little kids being Baby Groot. And
yep. Like you're going to see like a... You're going to see like parents who really pay attention to detail and quality and get like really good costumes or make really good costumes. Then you're going to see parents who are just like, fuck it, here's a bunch of leaves and twigs, you're Baby Groot now.
Just grab a plant from outside and staple it to the kid's head.
Yep, you're gonna see that. I bet you. Like, ever see really bad Deadpool cosplayers? They're noticeable.
So for people listening right now, we just lost our audio stream, and we're gonna hopefully have no mess ups when it comes to it, because we have a backup stream playing. But if you hear anything weird with the quality or whatever, that's gonna be the reason why. So it's good that we have our backups.
So for a cosmic scene like this, where there's like a aerial chase going on and a weird one-on-one duel that's one-sided, it makes up for like the scenes where not a lot of action happened in the last few like parts, you know, like it's even.
Yeah, like we had that whole like romantic kind of scene, and then even though there was a little bit of that fight with the cockfighting sort of thing, it really wasn't like an action scene. It was more so just like some tension a little bit. Now it's kind of like, well, we haven't had that. Thankfully, they don't do the kind of shit where it's like, we need an action beat every 10 pages of the script or something, where they just shoehorn something in. But it makes sense to do an action scene here.
And plus, this is, like, unconventional, because it's not, it started with a chase, then became, like, an action, like, watch them plow through alien tech. Yeah, I saw this movie in 3D, and this was a nice 3D scene.
Yeah, this is probably the best 3D scene. Which, I don't like 3D all that much. You know, the more that I've seen movies in 3D, the less I like it. But I'm going to be seeing Volume 2 in 3D, because the non-3D ones sold out a little bit quicker. I made a mistake of going to bed at a different time, and they went on sale like a couple hours before I had woken up, and I was like, son of a bitch, I don't want to sit in the front row, so let's all get 3D tickets instead.
Yeah, I made the mistake of not getting that right and saw Power Rangers in the first row.
Oh.
And, oh, that car crash scene in the beginning? Oh my god, I almost like got sick.
I can't do front row.
That was like the like, I swore to myself, never do front row, then like that was like, oh crap, now I'm in front row. I went from like a like almost 6 year movie streak of never seeing a front row, and now it's like, god damn, that broke.
You're like, well, I haven't had any neck problems for a couple of years.
So this scene right here with Lee Pace saying that line, it's like, I don't remember killing your like family, and then it reminded me of that like Street Fighter scene where Bison is just like, oh, to you, that's a, like, a lifetime ago, but to me, that was Tuesday. Like, it reminded me of that cheesy, like, he kills a lot of people. He doesn't know, keep track of it.
You were breaking up a little bit during that.
Oh.
You might need to repeat yourself.
Well, I said, like, it's crazy to think that, that, you know, Lee Pace's character, he kills so many people he can't keep track of, like, his kill list.
Yeah. Because, I mean, you could kind of expect that over the years, like, it's really important for Drax, but it's just another day for Ronan. Kind of like if you asked, like, James Bond, you know, it would be like, you know, you killed, like, my father. He was third henchman from the right in GoldenEye in the one scene of the archives. It's like, yeah, he's just another mook.
Yeah. I kill, it's just what I do.
Now, I've never seen anything else that Karen Gillan is in. I know she's in Doctor Who and shit, and I do not do
You didn't
Doctor
see Who. Oculus?
Nope.
Oculus was okay. It's not my favorite horror movie, but it's like, it's different.
Yeah, I usually don't do horror all that much.
Okay.
Because they're almost all awful.
Oh, boo.
There's like a good one every like 5 years.
Nah, like every two. It really depends what the trend is lately. I remember the, like, a few years ago, it was, like, found footage movies were, like, super hot, so...
Yeah, Paranormal Activity and stuff like that, too.
That kind of calmed down lately. Because people actually want to see quality.
And I'll get back to my Karen Gillan thing in a second, but that pool of all the green stuff, when I'm watching it for the first time, the only thought that popped in my mind was Family Double Dare.
Oh, my God. Just, like, a vat of gack.
Just get Mark Summers to come out and... Be like, no, the flag is still down there. You're still going to find another flag.
I was thinking, it's just like, this place has no safety regulation. There's just an open pool of just goop.
Yeah, and like, what is that supposed to be? Just it's celestial blood?
Celestial, like, matter that they're processing, I guess. But, yeah, just no regulation. Just an open thing of celestial processed material.
It might taste good. I don't know.
I don't know. No one ever tried, apparently.
It's like Ecto Cooler.
That's where it comes from. That's why it takes so long to get re-released.
Back to the Karen Gillan thing, though. She, in the movie, I wasn't really too familiar with what she even looked like before I had seen the movie. And not a fan of even short hair on women, let alone bald. But this whole Nebula look, I was like, kind of hot. And I'm looking at her with like the long red hair and stuff, and I'm like, I don't know, there was something weird about the Nebula look. She kind of looked hotter as Nebula to me.
Well, you preferred her as like the Sinead O'Connor look.
Yeah, it was like, it's a really strange thing that's not normal.
Nah, I don't mind it. It just, like...
I guess I dig me some blue.
Bald women, it's like, because you don't see it too often, it's always like, it's always distracting to some degree. It's like, oh man, that seems a little out of place. But, I mean, they're humans. So it's like, yeah, you gotta play fair. But Nebula's like a robot, so it's like a sexy, bald robot. That's like, okay.
Well, like Alicia Vikander and Ex Machina, it was like she's better with the hair, you know.
Yeah. She's better with like a full body that isn't translucent. Like,
yeah, that's a good point too. Of course, the best looking woman in the whole movie though is Gamora, but we also have a scene where we're just like staring at her face right now, so maybe that's a little bit influencing my opinion.
Yeah, for all I know, the anatomy is just bonkers, you know, like it's things are not where they should be.
Which if they have that, then that scene better be in the sequel. It better be like they get ready to bang and he's just kinda like, whoa, that I did not expect this.
Right. Because these are aliens, so it's not like they're always follow the same rules of what the human body looks like. Even this, like, he's doing like a tracheotomy, but he just did it like in his chest.
Yeah. And how does Groot know how to do that shit?
No idea. See, that's about Groot powers. It's just whatever he needs, he just does.
It's like, well, Groot can, he makes shields, he can grow, he also spontaneously has medical experience.
He has, like, surgeon precision to, like, get a drowned victim, like, up and running.
Because there's going to be a crossover of him in the Baywatch movie instead of, you know, he's going to be with The Rock on that one.
Instead of doing CPR. It's
Vin Diesel and Groot, so yeah. It'll be a whole thing where they're, like, talking about family.
Oh, yeah. Oh, man. Yeah, because, like, if you think about this, if you don't have oxygen in your brain for, like, a minute, your brain damage is really bad. He was there for a while in that, like, vat of, like, ecto-cooler.
Yeah, see, now if they would have done the whole thing with him not understanding metaphors after this.
Yeah.
He just starts drinking, it's just...
I also like this is like the most like they kind of move this movie pretty fast for a long, like for a runtime of 2 hours they move pretty quickly to like for scene to scene and for reasons quickly. Rocket just breaks down like, we have to do this. It's like, okay, like them banding together right now, like their bonding moment.
Well, it's also that kind of like trial through fire and like bonding over crazy experiences kind of a thing, but it is quick. I agree with you. They do kind of rush a little bit of it here and there.
Yeah.
It wouldn't work, though. Like, it does work because of the fact that Rocket questions it.
Yes.
Instead of just being like, yeah, I agree. We should have just, him just going like, oh my god, this is fucking stupid. I guess so. Like, here's Emperor Palpatine again. Hello. Slightly better. Now he's more of like a boss Nass. Be great if he's like, I got the orb, and I don't want to give it to you. And then he goes, boy. Which that really get a lot of people. I had thought of this ahead of time, not to like pat myself on the back or anything, but even in Avengers, I had thought about it. With this one, more particular, it was like, why would Thanos give the Mind Stone to Loki to go get the Space Stone? And why would he trust Ronan to get the orb and then just be like, can you give it to me? Like,
yeah.
Thanos is a lazy fuck.
Maybe,
you know?
Maybe Thanos was like, oh, it happened again. Like,
yeah.
He just stopped. He's
like, I can't trust Loki. Yeah. I can't trust Ronan.
You just don't. And
that's why he says that whole I'll do it myself thing.
Yeah, which takes two tries. You feel like, okay, maybe no more, you know, hire a middleman.
It's like, God, I'm not going to give you that orb. Now I have the power. And Thanos is like, bitch.
You're going to do exactly what I thought you were going to do.
He's like, come on, dude. I'll be your best friend. When you give me the power and then I have all the power, I'll make sure I don't kill you. So he says that he wants to, at the end of the movie, skip it forward. Yondu says that he had basically been contracted to bring Peter to his dad. And we know now Peter's dad is a goddamn planet, which means that he must have, like, somehow he came to Earth, impregnated Peter's mom, yet felt like he couldn't go back to Earth himself either, and wanted Yondu to go get Peter. So that's kind of interesting.
That's why I'm so eager to see the sequel for him, his deadbeat dad, to explain, like, what happened. Moses' excuse.
Dad, how come you never popped up anymore? Well, it's a little complicated. I mean, I am a fucking planet, kid.
It's like, of a planet, why are you a person now?
Snake? Apparently the kid knows all his fucking references, so... It is good casting, though, Kurt Russell being his dad.
Right.
Like, when this movie came out and they were talking about the dad issues, I wouldn't have thought Kurt Russell. As soon as they mentioned it, I'm like, yeah, I see it.
Especially since
his dad in the comics isn't Ego.
Yeah. But I'm just like, I'm trying to figure out, like, of the family tree lookalikes, like, Kurt Russell and Chris Pratt, I was like, yeah, maybe.
If you put Kurt Russell and the one who plays his mom together, I don't necessarily see Chris Pratt coming out of it, but it makes more sense than Adam Driver being the kid of Leia and Han.
Yes. Well, I mean, he kind of has the Harrison Ford nose, but not anything else.
And he's got the Hayden Christensen hair. And whininess. Rocket's such a great character, being able to just be like, he's not a cute little raccoon, he's a prick.
The psychotic tendencies are fun. Which, I guess, maybe because of the voice and the, like, attitude, the raccoon part just makes it even better.
I didn't think about this until you just mentioned about that kind of a thing, but you, in a different era, Joe Pesci would have been a great Rocket.
It would have been terrible CG or prosthetics, but it would have worked.
It could have worked. He's got that attitude. Raccoon how? How do you think I'm a raccoon?
think I'm small like a raccoon? Huh?
You think this is funny? Like that scene in Goodfellas where he's stabbing the dude. It's just kind of bring that intensity to it.
This is like a rated R. I could see
frickin' it. Frickin' frickin' frick for Home Alone. We got an ad lib coming up with the bunch of idiots standing in a circle. That was not in the script.
Really?
Huh. That was Sean Gunn just did that on the fly when they were recording the scene. This is a good scene, though. Like, this is one of those key scenes that really, like, like, it just gives you a lot of character moments that if you didn't have that, you might think later on at the movie that you needed a couple more, you know?
Right. Well, if you ever see more about James Gunn's movies, the writing is like this. It's fast-paced. Everyone kind of, like, knows their timing. Like, it's natural, but it's also very, like, you know, like...
Fluid.
Fluid, yeah, yeah.
Kind of like Tarantino.
Yeah. It's similar to that. Kevin Smith, Tarantino, like James Gunn, they know like dialogue scenes. They know how to like pay, like no one talks like this in real life. Like the kind of like wittiness, everyone's kind of on their game. But I mean, it works in a movie way.
Maybe people do talk like this, but the only reason why this is happening is because only one of the characters is human. And we are only used to all humans talking to each other.
True. Yeah, that helps.
Maybe in other galaxies, people are, like, really fucking witty.
Yeah.
And you needed a scene like this, the whole, like, let's band together, let's officially be a family now.
Mm-hmm. This is what you kind of, like, this is what made them, like, the Guardians. Like, in the sense where now they understand each other. Because they're still the same people. Now they're just, like, they're unison.
Yeah, they're not going to stop being jerks and buffoons and selfish and stuff like that, but it's, like, push comes to shove. They're good people. You got to know that it's, like, you know, the galaxy's at risk, so they're going to do the right thing, and they care about different other people other than themselves, and... You know, otherwise they would just be like, again, like Tarantino type of people where it's like, at the end of the movie, you watch Hateful Eight and you're like, yeah, I really didn't like any of those people.
Yeah.
Some of them are great. And Sam Jackson's character out of all of them is the one to like root for, it seems. But then you're like, yeah, but they're all real horrible.
Yeah, they're all awful people.
You got like racists and you got like sexists. And then you got the only woman in there is like a horrible bitch. At least, thankfully, none of the people in this movie are racist and stuff. It's not like they're like, well, we'll all fight this, but Gamora, nah, you can't because you're a woman or something, you know, like one of those kind of things.
You think Earth racism is kind of bad? Like, I might imagine galactic racism. Mm.
Whole entire planets just speciesism, being like, yeah. We don't talk to those people. When people make jokes that are like the stereotype jokes of like everything from like Asian people can't drive or like certain things, it's like then you go to another Earth or like another planet and stuff and people are like, oh, everybody from like Raxus 8 can't fly, like,
you right know? Yeah, they can't fly, right? They don't know how to take off, right? Like
exactly. Although I guess you kind of see a little bit in the movie where John C. Reilly's character's got the like the mixed race type of family.
Yeah, but it's like he doesn't get hate
purposely
for it.
Not like that. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. I always keep appreciating the quality
from the one planet.
Sorry.
No, go ahead.
I was gonna say I appreciate like some scenes with Rocket. They're very detailed in the fur. Like it's very almost looks realistic. Then some scenes super like got skimpy on the like the graphics. So like he kind of like stands out a bit.
A little bit, yeah. Well, they had a raccoon named I think Oreo. Was their like stand-in kind of. So they might have used like a couple shots where it's like close-ups. It's kind of like maybe they have like
real
the
fur.
Actual raccoon hair, yeah. Kind of implanted in there. I'd never know how any of that shit works. Like even when it comes to basic directing and people are like, well, they, you know, I needed this certain lighting for this kind of a thing. I'm like, story? I can tell you a story. Writing-wise, I can plot out things and I can be like, yeah, you need this certain beat at this point. You start getting into technical crap and it's like each frame is, you know, rendered at this capacity and whatever. I'm like, oh my God, it's all over my head.
Yeah. The lighting director is very important to like make sure the film doesn't just fucking like sink out. Like really bad movies. You could tell like the lighting director didn't pay attention when the camera switches cuts and you're like, wow, it's really bright now. Oh, it's really dark.
Yeah. That stuff I would be so lost on. That's why some people are like, you really like movies. Did you ever want to get into movies? Not like that, because I'd make a shit fucking movie.
Yeah, like, that keeps you humble, at least, where you know, like, you can't be everybody. You know, like, you can't just take up the whole role, because the movie's a big process.
Right. And certain people are just so good at, like, everything. It's insane. We got the crotch shot coming up there, yeah. Cherry Bomb is another one that I don't like that song.
You don't like Cherry Bomb?
Nope.
Why?
Not a fan of that one.
You heard it too much or you just don't like the message?
I tend not to like songs that seem like the people are shouting.
Wow.
Like screamo music, I hate it. I hate it all.
But this isn't screamo. This is like...
No, I mean, it's definitely not.
All right.
But the whole like, it's like, Cherry Bomb! Like that.
All right.
I don't know. Kind of reminds me a little bit of that... that old song, how the fuck does that go now?
We will rock
big
you.
Girls, they don't cry.
Oh.
That big girls, they don't
yeah,
cry.
Yeah, that song got covered so many times, I don't even know who really sings it anymore.
No idea. Painted every room.
Oh, no, I think, you know who sings it? It's, it's whatever the Jersey Boys is based off of.
Beach Boys?
No, Beach Boys and Jersey Boys aren't the same people.
Hmm.
Not the Temptations. It's something like that. It's some, like, you know, quartet group.
Well, that's definitely not Earth, Wind, and Fire, then.
No, it's so off.
Oh, and I forgot to mention, there's one Nova Corps member, a brunette woman, who is, like, really good looking. Like,
oh, yeah, she's like her assistant.
Yeah. And this was, I mean, the next year after this is The Force Awakens, and there's that one shot of Maisie Richardson Sellers, who is Leia's assistant, and she stood out in the movie, and she's in, like, one shot, and it was just kind of like, this woman's beautiful, like, what the hell was she, like, how did they not cast her in some other thing? And yeah, she had a bunch of deleted scenes and stuff, but...
She has the same haircut as, like, Princess Leia, like, the same braid style.
Oh, no, not her, not Billie Lord.
Oh.
Because that's Carrie Fisher's daughter.
Okay.
This is when they blow up, what's it called, Hosnian Prime. And there's that shot of, like, everybody turning, like, purple and, like, reddish.
Oh.
She's the one that you see in that, and you're just kind of like, whoa, who is this actress? And then now she's in Legends of Tomorrow as Vixen. She's been that.
Oh, that's Vixen? Not the same. I didn't know it was the same actress.
The one from Force Awakens, not the Nova Corps one. But yeah, same one.
Oh, wow.
So maybe that's going to give... maybe that woman there with the Nova Corps, maybe she gives Gamora a run for her money now that I'm thinking about it.
I don't know. We got to see more, like, shots from the waist down.
Let me rewind real quick. This whole thing with the net that they set up in a little bit, the first thing that I thought of when he gets destroyed, I was just like, how many hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people got killed there? And they don't really seem to think that much of it.
No, they don't.
It's just sort
of
like,
oh,
man, there goes the net.
And it's like, yeah, and like that, those are people in that thing.
Yeah, like 2,000 people just died or something. That's fucking awful. You just lost a good portion of your whole battalion.
So that's the thing about the Nova Corps, is, like, if they're Galactic Police, like, shouldn't there be way more to cover everybody? Or is that just, like, what's on the planet at this moment?
Yeah, like, this is the kind of thing where certain areas on, like, Earth where we have more police and then they don't cover certain areas. It's like, we don't go down that street.
That's a different county. Like,
yeah. It's not our jurisdiction.
Yeah.
We only care about Xandar. If you live that planet next to Xandar, you're out of luck. Where when they got killed, they were like, oh my god, we killed Lee Pace. And it was like, wait, that isn't Lee Pace. It's Peter Sarkin. And they're like, I don't care.
We've got our quota.
John C. Reilly's still fine. Glenn Close is still fine. Brunette's still fine. We're good. Now, with this movie, I don't think twice about the spaceships and stuff, but with Thor the Dark World, that felt really out of place.
They didn't have wings. It was just floating geometry.
And I can understand when people go like, yeah, well, it's Asgard. They're ancient. They would have better technology than we do. And it's like, yeah, but they also use swords.
Like, they're progressive in one side, but then just doesn't make any sense the other one.
Yeah, everybody here, well, except for Ronan, has guns. Ronan's just like, nah, I really was good at that game at the fucking carnival.
I'm really good with this. Yeah, her assistant right here. Super distracting. Yeah, Ronan's hammer, it looks something that I could buy in a store, like a specialty store here, you know, like someone who can craft like custom weapons. It's not too spacey futuristic, like there's nothing blinking on it.
That whole movie's just kind of, I mean, I thought that I would hate Guardians of the Galaxy when I went into this movie. I was like, this is going to be stupid. And it was great. And I thought that I would love Thor the Dark World. Probably my least favorite.
I don't mind Thor the Dark World. It's not like, it's not a movie I always want to throw on, but I appreciate it. I also rented it, so I thought my rental was amazing.
Oh, see, I watch these all opening night theaters. So that's $18 that I spent basically each time.
I went opening night, and it wasn't that crowded. You know, like, this was, like, it grew out of word of mouth, and then it became really popular.
Usually with these movies, with opening night, when I'm seeing it, you know, so, I, you know, you can overhear a lot of people when you're in the movies, no matter what and stuff, and a lot of people are like, you know, hey, do you think that, like, Red Skull's going to be in this movie for, like, a Captain America thing and stuff? But then with this, it's like, nobody knew what the hell to do.
Yeah.
And they're all just sort of like, well, if it was Spider-Man, I'd know what was going on. And if it was even Thor at this point, people started to kind of know a little bit more about Thor. But You tell people that there's going to be a scene in this where they're all going to be looking at a bunch of Firefly-looking things that came out of a tree.
No one would predict this.
No. This whole soundtrack, though, is this one of the best themes of the movie. Groot Spores, I think it's what it's called. Now, Nebula's got to be a better character the next time around, though. Like, she's got to be kind of like part of the crew, not part of the crew.
I think she's like unwillingly part of the crew. Like, she just, of like force or reason, she just is with them. But, you know, she's like looking for a way out all the time.
Yeah, like, I from what I've been able to piece together from the plot that we've been told so far, it's that they, like, not that they kidnap her, but like they arrest her essentially, and that they have her in captivity, and then it's like she kind of joins the crew a little bit, but there's always like that her against Gamora type of thing, and
yeah,
cool storyline.
I mean, you'd still be pissed if like your sibling shot you out of the space, like.
Yeah, I mean, I've been pissed at my sister for stupider things. So.
I love how they still watched him do this, and they don't. No one shoots at him.
Yeah, they're just going. He's whistling, and
this arrow.
Somehow,
is, yeah.
This shit's going through all of us, but it hasn't hit me yet.
I guess we'll keep watching, see what happens.
He can't whistle for that long, can he? Ow! Fuck, he can. She's flexible, though. You gotta give her that.
That's a plus.
Plus, that whole unhinging the jaw thing is like.
I think you're just telling me you're just really into like bald chicks who can dislocate their jaw. I think that's your thing now.
At least one of them. Now, I don't want to get a whole bunch of messages from people watching this that are like, I'm bald, I'm whatever. I'd be like, yeah.
You want me to watch me unhinge? Like, oh, man.
Plus, you know what, with this whole everything's falling out of the sky and all that, too, this is totally not in any way meant to discredit the shit that actually happens in real life, but we get, like, a bombing anywhere, you know, a train station, a car bombing, and it's, like, national news for, like, a week, or, like, the Boston Marathon, it's, like, this big thing, and you make a movie out of it, or whatever like that. Xandar is like they lost their entire fucking crew, and there's ships flying out of the sky, landing into there. The whole entire planet almost exploded and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. And it's like,
and it's just sort of like, oh man, that was a rough Tuesday.
Yeah, like, they repair real fast, like
right
at the end. Another thing is, it's also
criticism
sworn
of superhero
enemies,
movies
like,
that never does that. Although, you know what? To be fair. They refer to the incident with New York all the time.
So
they've kept that going. That they did a good job with that. But you never hear anything about the Thor of the Dark World stuff.
Well, because that was in London, and they got over. I think Marvel just knew Thor of the Dark World didn't make all the money, so
they don't try to like, we don't care if it happened in Britain. You know? Everybody knows how to fly, like. You gotta assume with anything like Star Trek, Star Wars, the different planets with Guardians of the Galaxy, that it must be like as easy as like driving a car kind of to fly.
I imagine like there's no tests. You just do it. Like you just get better at it by practicing, I guess.
You're in a world where you can call yourself Star-Lord and then other people do it, I guess so.
Yeah.
And they, like, you don't see many people kill other people in the MCU.
Oh, but this was one brutal fest watching, like, Groot, like, kebab people, and then, like, Drax ripped out a guy's brain.
Right, yeah, that's just, like... And it's played for laughs, too. Yeah. Like, Groot just smiles. He's just kind of like, I did good, didn't I? I impaled a bunch of people and smashed them left to right.
Murder is enjoyable.
At least when Hulk does it, he does it to alien things that you're kind of like, they don't seem like they're people, right. Sort of.
There's no human element to it.
Right. They clearly are some kind of weird android monster thing. But Drax ripped a dude's fucking brain out.
And a human dude. Like, that was, like, a human-looking guy.
Yeah. He ripped out the dude from the island. Like, you know? That's a good movie. I don't give a shit if anybody hates on that movie. That's great.
Eh.
Underrated movie.
Underrated?
Especially for Michael Bay. I think it was the first Scarlett Johansson movie I had seen.
Really?
Might have been.
She was on a lot of things as a teen, so it's like, I've seen her things when she was younger. I knew when she was growing up she was going to be hot. So here's like them losing all of the Galactic Police like on this planet.
And it's like, oh man, this is going to be a bitch to clean up. Which now they're even incorporating damage control in the Spider-Man movie, which is fantastic.
Which is good, yeah. I have like a few of their comics. I didn't really get it. I bought it because the covers looked nice when I was a kid. But, like, reading it now, I appreciate it.
It makes sense to have a Department of Damage Control. You gotta have somebody clean up the mess.
Yeah. Like, that's something, like, if superpowers became a real thing in our world, you know there would be all these companies just wanting to become something like that.
Insurance agencies would get on that immediately.
Yep, superhero insurance, definitely be a market.
Hopefully it's not as weird of a concept, though, as Powerless is on DC, because that show is not good.
That was supposed to be, like, an insurance company show. Like, the original pilot was, like, an insurance thing. And then they realized that was weird, like, because they didn't write it correctly. And then the Wayne Tech thing, like, I watched two episodes, I just gave up on that show.
Yeah, it's not good. I've watched every episode, I think. I might have to double check, but I know I'm supposed to be laughing from what they wrote, but it's not funny, so it's sort of like I'm not going to, you know? At least with Guardians, it's like the jokes hit. Every joke is... It might not be the funniest thing in the world, but... I mean, this whole thing with the... Building up the idea of this rocket that's going to explode them, and then it just doesn't work. It's like, yeah, it's kind of funny, like... That's their big, you know, we got this whole setup. It's kind of like the ex-wife in Iron Man 2.
Ex-wife?
That big missile.
Oh. And yeah.
He calls it the ex-wife.
I forgot that. Yep, the rocket that doesn't do anything. It's been a while since I've seen Iron Man 2. You don't see it on TV anymore.
It's another one a lot of people are kind of, like, iffy about.
I didn't mind it. I really liked Iron Man 2.
On its own, it's totally not as good of a movie as, like, Iron Man 1 or Guardians of the Galaxy is or whatever. But they needed that type of movie to bridge the gap.
Mm-hmm.
So I get it.
Just introduce,
they've got,
like,
some flaws.
Yeah, it's got flaws. Like, every movie's got flaws, obviously. But it built the world a little bit. Like, it introduced more, like... See, I mean, introduce Scarlet Witch and introduce, like, S.H.I.E.L.D. better. Like, it got the ball rolling.
You mean Scarlett Johansson?
Yeah, that's it. Sorry. Scarlett Johansson.
Yeah. There's even people that try to justify, which I'm like, no, that's not, it's a stupid thing to do. That people are like, they should retroactively make the little kid that is wearing the Iron Man suit that he saves at the end. They should make that a young Peter Parker. And it's like, no,
no, that makes no sense. Wasn't even New York City or anything.
Yeah, that stuff just, it's like, you don't need to go back and do that. You can change some things and you can kind of go like, well, that was a reference to this and stuff like that. But nah, that's going a little overboard. But they needed Iron Man 2 just to build up the Tesseract a little bit and that kind of stuff. And Guardians was like, we needed Guardians to set up a little bit more of the Infinity Stones, and we needed it to kind of
like build
get the, us used the, to
yeah.
the cosmic thing.
Yep, to introduce the cosmic thing without being such a like heavy-handed introduction.
Right. If people can accept the cosmic stuff with a tree and a raccoon, there's going to be no issues with Captain Marvel. And if they do, like, an Annihilation Wave thing in the future, nobody's going to be like, wait a minute, there's, you know, Silver Surfer and Annihilus, and I don't get this kind of crap. It'll just be like, yeah, it's the same fucking galaxy as the raccoon is. Like,
just enjoy the ride of this part.
Right. It's questionable, though, if he can say, we are Groot, probably should be able to say some other words.
Yeah, probably it took him so hard to say we.
He's like in overclock mode. Just and it's so ridiculous that it's like.
So
you get more emotion out of We Are Groot than you get in most movies.
Most Marvel movies, yeah. This is like that try to be emotional. And it's like, all this tree person said was, we are Groot, and we understood everything.
And you're like, yes, we are. We are Groot.
Indeed, Groot, we are. So,
speaking of... It starts being, like, political protests afterwards. It's like, you see people marching on Wall Street, and it's like, we all should get along. We're all Groot.
Yeah, it's like, instead of, like, we are the, like, the 99%, we are Groot.
People are filling out census surveys, and it's like, what religion are you, Groot?
Oh, man, I should have used that. Oh, if I had the chance to go back. I hope that becomes a trend. I hope that really, I mean, it's a little late now. It's like a three-year-old reference, but still, that'd been awesome.
Well, now Guardians of the Galaxy 2 will be out, so.
Yeah, but he probably's not going to say, we are Groot, because it's, like, meaningful here. If he says it, keeps on saying it, we are Groot. Just makes no sense then.
Maybe he says, we are baby Groot. Just change it up.
Oh, maybe. But I don't think he's going to do the trick of dying, like, being a ball again.
He protects a bunch of ants.
Yeah. He's too tiny to... Just covers their foot, like, oh, we're all dead, aren't we?
You got to protect those ants. Ants are Groot. Now, I never thought that they actually were going to be, like, killing Groot, because I figured if he can grow and all that kind of stuff, he'll be fine, but... That's also a byproduct of being, like, this cynical dude who's watched too many fucking movies, you know?
You just want to see, like, a main character die in a Marvel movie like this?
Kind of, every once in a while. I'm like, maybe the bad guy should win this one. Like, sort of, like, it would be depressing, and, like, I wouldn't want it to happen in certain movies and stuff. Like, when I thought that they killed off Batman in The Dark Knight Rises, I was like, you can't kill off Batman, like, what the fuck? But every so often, I'll come across a movie, and it's like, kind of wish that it would have just been like everybody dies at the end except for the bad guy gets away. And then you see something like No Country for Old Men and they do that. Mm-hmm. And then you're like,
it's meaningful.
I don't know how to feel about this. Like,
it's a different feeling, you know, it's not following the formula. And I appreciate movies like that.
And the same with this scene, the whole, like, you would have told me ahead of time, how do they beat Ronan? 20 ideas would have popped in my mind before dance. Sequence.
The dance-off challenge. So I like how the hammer still is weak to real bullets and, like, real weapons.
Yeah, if this dude wasn't so adamant about using that hammer... He pops up in, like, a scene in Thor Ragnarok where Thor's lost the hammer, and he's like, I don't know how to do this. And then he pops up, and he's like, trust me, the hammers aren't worth it. Like, And again, another byproduct of being a cynical dude who watched too many movies. When we saw the part at the beginning, or not at the beginning, but with the collector and the woman holding it, I'm like, this is going to pay off later where they're all going to hold it.
They're going to do the...
They're a team. And,
the,
you know,
the holding hands thing.
Right.
Where I'm like, I don't know how this works, but it's like they're just holding hands and calming the stone.
Yeah, like it's not the Mind Stone, so it's not connecting to their brains, but then again, it's all supposed to be kind of connected like that somehow, and they kind of tell you a little bit about how the ether works, and they kind of tell you a little bit about how the space stone works. Time, of course, it's just like, here's time, you know how clocks work and shit.
Yeah.
Power Stone.
You've had a VCR like, once.
Yeah, right. You have a fast forward button, it's cool. The Power Stone, though, it's just like, what do you mean it's just lots of power? Is it just pure energy? Like,
you just get the power of Prince. It's just purple rain over here. Well, the weird thing is, what's stopping, what's stopping Ronan
from grabbing at their hand?
Just joining in on this, like, circle. Like,
they're like, you're not our friend.
Yeah, like, couldn't anyone from the crowd just come up and grab them and just join the power?
Yeah, I guess so. Although I will admit, when this was happening, I thought that Groot would reform and be the final one. Instead of it just being like the four of them, basically.
Right.
But then I was like, they just had a Groot sacrifice scene. He's not going to be the one at the end that's just like, and he's also the one that can help control it and whatever. And then it would be like,
oh, like helps balance it. Yeah.
Thanos is beaten by a tree in the end. The movie's written by M. Night Shyamalan.
No, the twist would be like if he was dead, and this has always been like a fever dream of his.
So another thing that happens with these Marvel movies is they don't kill off villains a lot. And even though Ronan explodes there, I mean, we got Red Skull transporting into some other kind of realm.
Which I wish they address. I really hope they address that.
I really am hoping that what we get for Infinity War is that he brought back, like, a couple of those people. And it's like, I studied your history. I know that, like, Captain America first popped up with this Red Skull thing, and he's one of my lieutenants now, like, that kind of a thing. Like, the Masters of Evil sort of a thing.
I hope they're, like, they're in the gem, you know? Like, I hope they're just, like, kind of, like, hang out, and then Thanos, like, unleashes them, like, because they're part of the gem.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
That'd be cool.
Because you got the Aether, you got, with... What's his name? Malekith. And I guess you kind of have... You might not have what's-his-face from Doctor Strange in the mix, but...
No. Well, unless the...
Ultron a little bit with the Mind Gem. Like,
yeah, I could see that. Yeah, I forgot.
Maybe even if not like that they fight them and stuff, maybe it's just sort of like a quick flash of it, like when he's activating the powers or something. Like, that'd be kind of cool, though. I'd like that.
Or just like... digitally insert them in the movie. You know, like weird CG cut of them.
Pull a Tarkin.
Yeah. Kind of yeah. Oh, they just called Kurt Russell a jackass. Also, Chris Pratt with like curly hair is weird. Even though that's like his natural hair, it's like curly.
Yeah, he like didn't put anti-frizz in it or something. And that was weird, too. When they first announced that they were casting Chris Pratt, I was like, I had only really known him a little bit from here and there, like a little bit parts and stuff. And all the images on like Google image searches and stuff like that, I was just like,
oh, they're not, dude. Yeah, they're not impressive. Like his like early picks.
Now, he had gained a whole bunch of weight just to be like a comedic, funny, fat guy kind of a thing. Mm-hmm. And it was like, I mean, he wasn't like fat, fat, but it was like, you don't picture that being like Star-Lord, you know, main superhero of this movie kind of a thing and all that. And I was just kind of like, oh, man, this fucking tree movie with the fat guy. And I thought it was like it was going to be that Jack Black Green Lantern movie that we had heard about and stuff. And
well, I would have preferred that over what we actually got, like, in retrospect now.
That's a good scene, though, with that him petting Rocket.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody, all the speculation about what Quill is, and like, what does this mean? Is he part?
Oh, another distractingly like, hot like assistant right next to Glenn Close,
the blonde one. Yep. Yeah. They did a casting call. It was like, we need some hot ones, and they both showed up that day, and they were like, both.
Yep, you're both in it. What do you play? Same characters, just assistant.
Great. If you look it up and it says hot assistant and everybody else is just labeled assistant, mm-hmm. How would you feel if you were cast as one of the non-hot ones?
Your background assistant, like one of these women, right? Just facing the wall.
It's got to be awful when you're cast in a movie and it's like you're playing the part of like super ugly next door neighbor and they're like, you're perfect for it. You know?
Oh man, that's a blow to the ego. I like Gamora's outfit. It's like business ready, but it's also like ready for battle. Like, it's confusing.
It's like a uniform at like, I don't know, like she kind of seems like she should be working at like a medieval times a little bit, like, I don't know, the cleanup crew or something like that. But at the same time,
yeah, the leather
futuristic.
It's
right.
It's just everywhere in that costume, but space clothing, whatever.
It works. Yeah. I got no complaints. And it's a little bit, makes more sense than the shit that Leia was wearing in the original trilogy.
Like bedsheet.
George Lucas saying they don't have bras in space. It's like, it's creepy, dude. Kid's 19. You know? I don't think John C. Reilly is in the new movie.
Well, on the new movie takes place on this planet anymore, so you don't always have to have John C. Reilly, but...
That's true.
It'd be nice if it's a callback if he's in it.
There should be some kind of Nova, like, reference or, you know, maybe when they, like, come across another planet's Nova Corps member or something like that, like, just to kind of keep that fresh in everybody's mind, just be like, remember... Nova Corps is a thing for the future, that kind of thing.
Not even the future, that's just a thing in space. So it's like, they could pop up at any time.
No, I mean the future, like the movies and stuff.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
So that way, if they do it in like Captain Marvel, or they do it in like a spinoff movie or something,
right.
We're not going to be like, wait, who are these guys?
Yeah, again? If one shows up in Black Panther, it shouldn't be too surprising.
Yeah, well, even at that point, it would be like, huh? Like, Black Panther, all right. I know a lot of people think that the Soul Stone is going to be in Black Panther, and I'm like, I don't see that happening. It could, but
I think that'd
makes so much more sense in Ragnarok to me.
It'd just be weird for, like, Black Panther, Soul Stone. I was like, man, like, they just really do that.
I didn't even think about that.
I thought about that. I'm like, you know, they were trying to go for that, and they're just like, nope, we're not getting to that problem.
It's what's a soul glow type of thing reference.
It's the power of disco. Like, no, we're not doing that.
It's like, what does the time stone do? You can control, you know, different realms with the time and space and whatever like that. And what's the soul stone do? Make some great food.
yeah, that's like the one Disney executive who thought that. They're like, get out of the room.
And we were talking earlier about the music and stuff, and I don't know if your school did this, but when Remember the Titans came out, my school made it like a trip that it was like, let's all go to see this movie. And everybody fucking loved Ain't No Mountain High Enough.
It was like,
and I was like, this song is pissing me off. It's so like
overplayed.
People are singing it on the bus back from the movie and everything. And I'm like, ugh. And then when this movie came out, and you know, just the shot from about a minute ago of, like, the beginning of it with Peter, like, all upset and stuff. I was kind of like, oh, crap, I like the song now. Like,
it goes through a bunch of renewals. It also has, this is, like, not as overplayed. It's a nice end theme where Ain't No Mountain High Enough was, like, everywhere in that movie.
Right. That was, like, the reason that movie existed.
They heard that song and went, yeah, we can make a movie around this.
I mean, you know that the same people that do that didn't do the Big Girls Don't Cry.
I was wondering how big the ship is where, like, they can have enough room for these people to, like, sleep and eat and...
It's definitely nowhere near as big as the Ravager one.
Right,
it seems.
Right.
And the Black Aster is, like, fucking huge in comparison, too. But it does have enough room for Barit to be stashed in the bottom part. Instead of the dancing Groot, that Guardians of the Galaxy will return thing. I'm usually used to James Bond will return. And it's like, Guardians of the Galaxy will return in Octopussy.
You know, does, I think what company lost so much money when they made the dancing Groot that didn't dance?
Mm.
It took them like two more prototypes to get it right, where actually you could buy like a dancing Groot pint, like little toy thing.
And it's not even new technology. No. They used to have those little cans that you could clap your hands and it would do it.
Yeah, so it's just like, if they sold that like a week after this movie, they would have made so much. It would have been like the Furby kind of
thing. Yeah, it would have made so much bank. That would have been just... Because this came out in August of 2014. So that Christmas would have just been so much Baby Groot stuff. And this Christmas isn't going to have like as good of a... Because it's May this year, so it's like another extra couple of months to kind of push it out of that. But if they would have had a prototype, like you said, that, like right afterward... Little plush thing.
Yeah, little plush, like, or just... Or even like a battery-powered plastic piece of thing on your desk, like... Did not even do that.
I keep bringing up Star Wars in this, but they knew what they were doing when it came to the BB-8. The little BB-8 ones were like marketed before the movie even came out because everybody was like, "The little ball is so fucking cute."
Like, we were at Comic-Con together when we saw that. Like, we were just like there's that booth that had the little BB-8 that you could roll around.
A bunch of like 30-year-old guys and we're all like, I want to see the fucking ball.
Yeah. Like, that's a huge line to see it like just roll around in that RC pit.
If it would have been cheaper, I would have bought one.
That was not cheap.
$200 or something. I'm like, I could buy a TV for that much. No.
And then, because it's like, all you need is one person not paying attention and walk on that.
Hmm. Or like, a little kid thinks it's a ball that they can kick, you got a dog that thinks it's a toy that they can chew, and you're out $200. The hell with that.
Like, yeah, like if made like a cheap version, it was like 30 maybe, but I guess it's really complicated to get like the top of BB-8's head like always perfect while it's moving.
But you do know with this movie, with Baby Groot being the size of like a water bottle, they're going to figure out some stuff ahead of time for that.
Oh, yeah.
That'll be little, like, instead of, like, when little girls have, like, a doll that's, like, you know, baby wets herself or something like that. It's, like, they put some kind of, like, whatever those chips are that makes that stuff do that randomly. Get little Baby Groot that'll kind of say, I'm Groot, randomly and stuff. Like,
here's a free tip for the people who do Chia Pets. Make a Chia Baby Groot. You would make a lot of money.
Mm.
Or in fact, let me actually. I'm gonna copy that right now. Just like I'm gonna patent that, like Chia Pet Baby Groot.
It's not like you could do it with any of the other movies. You can't have like Chia Hulk.
Yeah,
you
know? Like how many movies have a talking plant?
Let's see. There's Monster Calls.
Well, like there's like Swamp Thing, which is Marvel owned. DC. No, Man-Thing.
Marvel has Man-Thing.
Man-Thing. It's like the equivalent of the Swamp Thing. And it's like, he's not as vegetated as Swamp Thing is. Where Swamp Thing is just looks like moss and like tree roots. Man-Thing is like, he was like a roided out like elephant man.
Yeah, he's like mini Cthulhu or something.
Yeah, so he's not as vegetated. Like, he has no vines, but...
No, but I don't think anybody with even a Swamp Thing is going to be like, oh, that's so cute. Like,
yeah. You know? I want that dancing.
Look at cute little Alec. Although I bet you if they made a Chia poison ivy, people would buy it. Those waifu type of people.
That would be disturbing, though. Just like she's kind of like bland without any like growth, but the moment like I don't know month one, Shivani has some vegetation on it. It's like, yeah, that's my shit.
You know what's another thing that's great about these Marvel movies? No other movie in, like, the history of motion pictures has ever prompted people to stay through the credits as much as these Marvel movies do.
Yep.
Nobody gives a shit 20 years ago about credits. Then you get Nick Fury pops up at the end of Iron Man, and I remember that movie I went to see by myself a couple days after it had been out, because nobody wanted to see Iron Man.
Really?
And I was just like, why doesn't anybody want to go? And they were like, it's Iron Man. It's going to be stupid, dude. I don't want to see it. None of my friends wanted to go see it. So it was like, I usually try to go, you know, that Thursday night, that Friday night or whatever. Finally got to a point where, like, nobody wanted to go Saturday. Nobody wanted to go Sunday. And I'm like, fuck it. I got to go see it. So I went to see it on a Monday afternoon. And all the people that were in the theater didn't know that there was an after credit scene. And they're all getting up, and I was just like, hold on, there's another scene at the end. And people are like, what do you mean there's a scene at the end? And I'm like, you don't know that they do that in certain movies and stuff? And then it was like, now it's not only a scene like that, but mid-credit scenes, and supposedly there's 5 for Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2.
But then it's like, then that's too much. That's not a mid-credit scene. That's just like part of the movie.
Yeah, I don't know how they're going to do 5. I guess it might, like, maybe they are structuring the credits in a weird way or something, like, where they're going to do, like, here's all the visual effects, and then it'll be like, here's a scene, and then here's all the music, and then here's a scene or something like that, but, or maybe it's, like, they cut to black, and then they kind of go to another scene anyway or something, like, just to kind of, like, we filmed a whole bunch of this stuff, and we want to show it to you anyway or something, but I don't know, it's weird. Oh, and I forgot to mention it. It says at the end that no raccoons or tree creatures have been hurt in the making of this movie.
I didn't notice that. That's pretty cool.
And you get Howard the fucking Duck.
Did not expect that at all.
Not in the slightest bit. I was expecting it to be something about the Infinity Stone. Sort of like, Collector's hanging out, and then, like, Thanos pops in and goes, like, where's that fucking stone or something? And nope, Seth Green playing fucking Howard the Duck.
Which got people like, excited for more Howard the Duck, though.
Which is insane. Like, we got Howard the Duck in a movie before we got Nightwing.
Yeah. Thanks. Thanks, movie gods.
Alrighty, buddy, well, your video should be ending, or if you're a little bit behind or something like that, it should be over already. And that does us for our audio commentary track, but thank you for listening to this. Make sure that you hit that subscribe button on YouTube, or follow us on Facebook, Twitter, you know, any other kind of stuff that you're out there. Same thing for everything action. Cheng, you want to throw anything out there for people to follow?
Thanks.
Anything specific or anything?
Yeah, you could see where I write and my friends write at everythingaction.com, or check out our Twitter at EVAction.
Yeah, go ahead and subscribe over there for all of his good stuff. And I don't know the next thing that I'm going to be posting on the Fanboys channel, but I'm assuming it's probably going to be the Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 reviews. So if you followed this one because you like Guardians, then stay tuned, because that'll be popping up sooner than later. Maybe it'll be something else in the meantime, I don't know. But if you follow the wrestling side of things that I'm doing, check all that out on smarkoutmoment.com. And yeah, I think that's about it. So thanks for watching again, everybody. It's time for us to geek out. Adios.